Thank you, Aisha, very much for your kind invitation, your kind words. I also, first of all, want to thank Professor Belyaev and Professor Karashun for their kindness to have me here, invited in St. Petersburg, and also the kindness to be attending in the hospital of Professor Karashun. I adapted my slide because I saw in the English program that my talk was set, how did I become an oncologist? I have to say I'm a surgical oncologist, but nevertheless, I think I would like to I would like to take you with me on a journey. This beautiful mountain you see here is the highest mountain of Germany. It's nearly 3,000 meters high. It's called the Zugspitze and is in the Alps, so in the very south of Germany. And let's imagine that our goal is to climb that mountain together and to reach the level of a surgical oncologist. What is the goal? We want to enjoy this beautiful view. We want to get a lot to know. We want to get a lot of experience in surgery oncology to reach our goals. Just some words about the specialty of surgical oncology. Professor Dugo already explained to you the concept, and I'm very happy, and I totally agree that the surgical oncologist in the MDT is the most important person and in taking decisions together with all other specialties. So just briefly, the concept was implemented of surgical oncology in the ESO in 2003. It is a two-part exam, so it is a multiple choice questionnaire and is an oral exam. And usually you have to perform 2 years after your specialty in a specialized center for surgical oncology. There are many centers recommended by the ESO in every country. You can go online, you can check host centers which are specialized on your specific field, and you can get trained there, or even your center is specialized for this. In addition, you need also some academic work during this specialty, so you should be involved in research. And you should also evaluate papers, and one part of the oral exam is to discuss two scientific papers. Then there's a logbook, so you need to show that you also performed and assisted enough surgery procedures to get this exam, and the examination is annually. Just to show you, surgical oncology in many countries in Europe is not the lived reality. So many countries have subspecialities which are organ-based. So either you're a hepatopancreatic biliary surgeon, or you're a colorectal surgeon, or you're upper GI surgeon, or breast surgeon. This specialty of surgical oncology implements every of these fields. So you see, when you do the written test, you have to know about every specialty. And this, at least for me, was quite hard, and you had to sit down in the evenings and to study these topics. The oral exam is then more specialized, so you can choose out of these specialties three subspecialties, and then on-site the referees will choose two subspecialties. For myself, it was upper GI and colorectal and peritoneal surface malignancies. And also important, the cost of all these examinations, so the written test and the oral test, and also the certification process, is 600 euro. Here you see just a brief overview about the successful participants in surgical oncology during the last year. So we have now 15 years of surgical oncology exam, and you see it's around 15 to 20 participants which were successful. Just briefly about myself, that you also know what I did in my past. So I'm 39 years old. I'm married. We have two beautiful boys. I'm a German citizen, and I'm happy to have moved 6 months ago to Lisbon, to Portugal, to work at the Champalimaud Foundation, which is a cancer institute. And I graduated from medical school in 2007, had an experimental doctor thesis about TNF-alpha regulation and release in a cell culture. I specialized in Germany for visceral surgery in 2014, and subspecialized for special visceral surgery, and also the European Board, the Surgical Oncology, in 2018. But coming back to our journey, so we we aim to get to the surgical oncologist exam. So we have in this mountain, I know it very well because I lived there for nearly 8 years in that region. We have different ways to go there. So, for example, we have a very beautiful and direct way, which takes usually 6 to 7 hours because you have to get 2,000 height meters up to the Zugspitze, which is a little bit of climbing. You have some experience in climbing, then this is the most beautiful way. Then we have, of course, different other ways to get there. There's another way coming from Austria to the top of the mountain, which takes you usually 8 to 10 hours because it's not as steep. And a third way, which is a very long way to through a valley behind the Zugspitze, which takes you 2 days. So whatever way you choose to get to your goal to be a surgical oncologist, you should feel comfortable with it. Of course, there are also different ways to get to the peak of the Zugspitze, like for example the old historic train or the just very newly manufactured cable car to get to the Zugspitze in just, I think, 7 minutes. But coming back to the journey, I think during the journey is very important, and I share my own experience with you here, is to have the right equipment and on the way of your journey to get your backpack filled with beautiful things and experience you get during this journey. So for example, if you know you want to go to the direct way to the Zugspitze, you should, of course, take a rope, your climbing shoes with you, and then you are prepared for your journey. If you know you want to have an overnight stay, you, of course, take other things with your backpack. But one of the most important things is that on every episode of your journey, you are taking things to learn, and you are raising your experience. So this is the timeline of my experience until today. So I'm nearly 12 years in surgery, and I started after the med school in Munich in a small hospital at the foot of the Zugspitze. This was a district hospital. It was a very good hospital. I learned a lot. I learned mainly basic general surgery, so I operated a lot of hernia procedures, I operated a lot of open colorectal procedures, also thyroidectomies were the main focus of that hospital. And during that time, my first boss, he was a vascular surgeon, he was the president of the Ultrasound Society in Germany. And he told me, Andreas, the first position is not your last position, so try to get as much as you can for your track to reach the top of the mountain. And during that 4 years, I was not especially focused on ultrasound, but I did more than, I think, 1,500 ultrasound procedures, and I learned about that technique. And I just want to tell you that maybe at your stage, you have some things to learn, you have the possibility and expertise in your unit to learn, you should take advantage of that. Every step is important for your career. And then after 3.5 years, I was thinking, is this really it? Do I really want to continue here the next 20 years? And I was thinking myself, no, that's not it. I wanted to see bigger. I wanted to see the whole picture of the visceral surgery, including mainly hepatopancreatic surgery, also including transplantation. And at that time, I was talking to my first boss, and he recommended me to go to the university hospital, which I did. So I moved then from Garmisch to the next university hospital in that region. And this was Innsbruck in Austria. It is a very renowned hospital for especially transplantation and also hepatopancreatic surgery. And during this, a little bit more than 3 years, I learned a lot about transplantation. I was, after my specialization, a transplant fellow in that unit. And it was really exciting to get trained in kidney transplantation, organ procurement, to assist liver transplantation because I was still too young at that age. And the next step I learned in Innsbruck was doing research. My boss told me, university hospital, when you want to succeed, you need to do research. And for me, the first step to get into research was clinical research. So I was adapting databases, first of all colorectal, but then also liver transplantation. I was writing my first publications in Innsbruck, and it was a very beautiful time there. And also because I was supported by my boss, I was then, after 3 years, moving to Berlin. because my head of department in Innsbruck became head of department in Charité, and he was asking me if I want to join him, and I decided that this might be a good step for me, for my career. So then I moved to Berlin, and in Berlin, the situation was a bit different. Berlin is a very big transplant center. They had a lot of surgeons, young surgeons, motivated surgeons, also like me. And the boss told me, well, don't you think surgical oncology might be something for you? And I was thinking about it, and I decided then to catch that opportunity. I was mentored by Beate Rau. She's a very renowned person in the peritoneal surface malignancies, especially in Germany, but also in Europe and all over the world. And for me, it was a unique opportunity to get more expertise in the field of oncology, because you have a huge variety of oncology cases. You have the gastric cancer, you have the colorectal cancer, you have appendiceal neoplasm. So it was a very beautiful way to expand my knowledge and also my surgical skills to cytoreductive surgery and HIPEC. And during that time, I also learned to establish myself in societies, in national but also international societies. I joined the ESSO, and I got in contact with other centers in Europe. I did fellowships in other centers, and it was a very fruitful time for me to learn and to get closer to my step to become a surgical oncologist. Now, since 6 months, I work in Lisbon, in Portugal. I had the peritoneal malignancy program there and also the upper GI program. And it's a very different way to work because we are very focused only on cancer surgery of GI cancer, but it's very beautiful also to have time to raise more topics in basic research. I want to tell you that being a surgical oncologist is not a one-person show. It's teamwork. During your way, I showed you a little bit my way. It's important to have partners, to have collaborators, to have a good and strong team which is trained, to be in good cooperation with other departments. And this is the same on the mountain. You should never go alone on a big mountain. This is a rule. So, as I already mentioned, I received in 2016 a fellowship grant from the ESSO for a clinical fellowship, and I decided to go to the biggest center for peritoneal surface malignancies in Europe or the world. And I went to Basingstoke, and I was there for nearly 3 months doing a short clinical fellowship, and it was a great experience. They are by far the most experienced colorectal surgeons and peritoneal malignancy experts. And I spent there beautiful 3 months. I established friendships. I established also connections for research. I'm about also to publish my research I did there in a clinical research project about peritoneal mesothelioma. And these friendships, I just can tell you, they continue. They will always be there. And this is very helpful. And I just can encourage you to do fellowships, to go abroad, to see other units, because they work, they have the same problems as you, or they had the same problems and solved them. It's a very beautiful way. Another great experience I had in Japan, so this was from the German society. I got a travel grant, and I visited the unit of Dr. Yonemura. He's 70 years old. He's an excellent surgeon, and he is the person with the most experience worldwide with gastric cancer and peritoneal metastasis. So he has a team, he works and operates in 3 different hospitals, and I visited him for 3 weeks, and it was very wonderful to discuss problems, indications of the patients, because they have a different world in Japan to treat peritoneal malignancies. It was very interesting. I have to speed up a little bit, but here you see collaborations also in Lisbon. So you might know Alvaro Ariona Sanchez and Angela, his consultant. He's in Cordoba in Spain. He's running the HIPEC T4 trial for colorectal cancer in Spain as a PI. And we also have a good collaboration established in the last months about basic research projects. And I don't have to introduce these two wonderful surgeons. you already know them, and I'm also very happy to them to be here in St. Petersburg and also to learn from them about laparoscopic gastrectomies. But it's not only about learning, it's also about giving. So I'm for 4 years now in international and national courses in the faculty. I support the ESSO course in Hamburg every year. I'm very happy and honored to do so. And we have several participants there, also Professor Andrei Domansky from St. Petersburg was 2019 here, and it is a very beautiful way to establish connections and also to support and to help in whatever problem they also might have, because we had the same problems. This is the unit in Lisboa, in Lisbon. So this is Professor Figueiredo, the head of the digestive surgery there, and it's a very beautiful and nice way to work there. I'm coming to my last slide. It's about mentorship. Mentorship is very important, because I don't know anybody, any surgeon or any young surgeon who really knew from the first day and also the way to get to achieve his goals. If you want to go, let's say, in the Himalaya to a mountain and you don't know the area and it's very high and dangerous, you get a Sherpa or you get a guide to help you. And this is the same in the surgical oncology. I'm very thankful to my mentors, and I show you my four mentors. This is Stefan Nöldeke. He's a vascular surgeon from Garmisch. I already told you that he told me that you have to take the things and you have to learn from the people you're surrounded, and everything you put in your backpack, and one day you're very happy what you have in your backpack. Second person is Professor Holger Vogelsang. He was trained by Professor Sievert in Munich. I was also there as a student, and I already know him for 20 years. And he motivated me, and he also shared the experience, like Domenico said. We are surgeons, but we have to know much more than just surgery. It's about treating the whole patient. It's about knowing the same things or even better than the medical oncologists, the trials. And he inspired me in that way, that because he was known in Munich in the University Hospital to be a very smart and bright person, that he always was a little bit better than the medical oncologist in the MDTs. And this is very helpful, and this is something I can advise you as well. Then this surgeon is Professor Johann Pratschke. He's head of the Charité, of the Department of Surgery. And I worked with him for nearly 8 years, and I'm very thankful to him, because I learned a lot of strategic things with him. So how to set up basic research projects, how to get it funded, how to motivate your team. It was a very beautiful time, and we still keep friendship. And last but not least, I have to thank, of course, Beate Rau. She's a wonderful mentor. I was 4 years working with her together and learned several techniques. She supported my trips, my fellowships to the UK and also to Japan. And it's very important, I just want to say, that you have a good mentorship and you follow their advices, because in nearly every case it's just to your best to do so. So just briefly about the exam. So I passed the written exam in June in Vienna. This is a completely computer-based test, about 100 questions about every surgical oncology field. The oral exam was then in Budapest at the ESSO Congress. And was, as I said, you get two scientific papers, you discuss these papers with the referees, and then you also get clinical questions about the two subspecialties, mainly case discussions. In the end, I got this this piece of paper with the surgical oncology board qualification from the European Board of Surgery, and then I was thinking back to the mountain, and I was thinking, okay, now I have this beautiful view here on the mountain, now I have the certificate of a surgical oncologist, but now what's up next? Or what does it help? It's not like a driving license that from that day you can drive a car, you just go. And I have to tell you, for me, the journey is the reward. Of course, you enjoy the beautiful view from the mountain, But in the end, as I showed you during these years, during this experience I was happy and lucky to have during my fellowships, it's mainly, I think, about the journey. Of course, you get experience, you get knowledge, all these skills and certificates, as Domenico already said, but the journey is the reward. Thank you very much for your attention.